Hi, my name is Xiang. I'm from Alibaba Cloud. So, who sponsored my travel? So I need to add the logo. So, EROFS is a big, basically a block-based read-only file system, but its format is very simple. Why we introduce it? Because that the previous FS has many limitations. So, for many use cases, we don't actually need to for such read-only use cases that we mostly use a more compact format, but the exist file system, I think that the only squash FS is the only choice before we introduce EROFS, because the other file system has many limitations, both on the image size or it doesn't support compression. So we would like to our internal use case is mainly aimed to the performance. When we once use Squash FS, but eventually we failed, so that we want to build efficient file system on the block based. So our FS is block aligned data. So that is for page cache friendly, because that we don't need to do another memory copy to do online data for such thing. That if we do a block line aligned data, so we can do a direct IO and FS stacks. And our metadata, so that's including inodes and directory browse, doesn't across block boundary. So that makes somewhat somewhat different to Squash FS. Squash FS has a block size concept as well, but its block size is a compression unit. It's just like a compression unit. So its uncompression size is its block size, but its compressed size is actually a variable. It can be a better granularity. So that is not block aligned. So another is that our directory data is random access friendly. The other FS that is too simple, so that it can just do a linear search, and so that is quite effective. And the image size needed to be large enough. That is EROFS basic concept. Another is that we might need to provide a SQL archetypal file system replacement of a traditional CPIO or NTAR. I saw some use cases which try to pass through the tuple directly to a guest, because that their tuple is collected by its SHA. So we don't want to modify it. They introduce another new file system, like a new in kernel tile FS. But I think in such use cases, we can use UFS to to replace it as well. So I think that such use cases that we can just use the original tar data and build a EROFS merged metadata to point to such data, so the original tar data won't be modified. So we also have such proof of concept. So that is a benchmark between the directly mount EROFS and Turbo after fetching from remote instead of just uncompacting a tar to such as EST4. So the whole startup performance is speed up. So I think that might be a use case, at least to pass through some container images to guests, maybe or just the wrong thing. But there are still some problem. I think that for such uses, still have some problems such as page cache sharing. So I think that it might be need to be discussed. So in this use case, the page cache sharing might be problem.
This reminds me of the ButterFS XT4 snapshot.
Yeah. We probably should talk about this later because it's probably going to be a very long discussion. But yeah, I agree that the container images have these problems. These are very, very big problems, and it's the thing is that when it comes to page cache sharing and all these other problems, my view is I think that all of them, well, not all of them, that's too grand. A lot of them can be solved is if we didn't have tar archives in here. If we had another format where we would be able to have per file granularity and we share the files as the same inode on disk, and then the kernel knows that it's the same exact file, and we don't have to worry about having a file system where we're mounting. Like, yeah, that's my view, because I agree that if we changed nothing about the image format and we try to work around problems in the image format, this is probably a better thing than what we're doing at the moment. The thing, though, is that in my view, we need to change the image format. I think that, like, I've seen so many talks about people trying to figure out ways to, like, optimize building images because things are based on tar, and in my mind, this is insanity. Like, we need to fix this format so that it's not, so people are not working around it, like, spending, like, hundreds of human years of life on trying to get work around tar archives. My blood boils when I have to think about this, because it's like it's so much wasted energy and thing. My point is that I think that we could definitely figure out better ways of doing it, but we should have a discussion later, because I think that I'm sure you have lots of really good ideas about how we can solve it. But yeah. Sorry. Right, but the thing is that if you didn't have to, if it wasn't a tar archive and we didn't have basically, you would not, like, you'd be able to have container images which don't have, like, if you have Ubuntu Linux that has, like, 1.64 gigs, well, if it's one layer, that's one thing. But if you look at, like, I don't know, if you have look at the Open JDK, for instance, basically, you'll be able to share stuff between images, which you can't do with the layer format. So you'd have to, like, if you have the same copy of Bash in every single container image you have, but there's, like, 5,000 copies of container images in your system, you'll be able to share the exact same inode for all of them. You can't do that with a tar system. You need to rethink it. Like, that's my view. So there are other sharing you can do. So this improves that, but I think that if we could take ideas from this and come up with a better format, we could have something that's way better. Sorry, I didn't mean to derail it. Sorry, you can keep going.
Yeah, I don't want to change the table anyway. So because that is last deployed. So that is I think that we need to do a compatible solution. At least, my opinion.
But I maintain the specs, so we can change it.
Okay,
like
okay,
that's my point.
Okay,
yes.
Okay.
So I'm not speaking as someone. I'm one of the maintainers of the specs. Like, we can change it. I think, and if we can argue that all this loss, we take these graphs and we point to people, we say we need to fix this.
Okay.
I think that will be a very convincing argument.
But in this way, that we have another problem to avoid page cache sharing, because that if we want mount two different EROFS. With a same, we need to aware different file system and to do page cache.
Okay, so I'll let you keep going, sorry.
Okay, so finally, that we might need to do a generic page sharing approach. I asked Willy previously, but that I didn't get some answer, or at least some pass. So I have some hack, at least to share page cache in the file level, but that is not enough if we want to do file duplication, final duplication, such as a chunk or some. EROFS supports chunk-based deduplication, so I think the typical use case together with NIDAS. So the NIDAS is Alibaba stuff. So that's initially not related to EROFS. Anyway, so optionally, and it supports poor file LD4 and LDMA compression. But there's some difference about this because so EROFS actually use approach such as a fixed size output compression. So why we need that? Because that compared with the previous approach, such as ScratchFS, that is not quite efficiently to compress a small block, such as 4K block. Why we need that? Because that if you want to do some I/O. You need some compressed data to load, so you need to allocate you need to allocate memory for compressed data, and then you whatever copy to page cache or something. So the memory is amplified. So for the performance sensitive use cases, we need smaller compressed block, but the previous solutions are not quite effectively. I will explain later. So we introduce to avoid this, that we also introduce in place I/O to avoid allocate compressed page buffers as much possible, so that we can reuse the page cache, reuse the original page cache to contain the container compressed data first, and then time sharing to decompress in place. So we also maximize the in-place and the cache I/O to cache compressed data to save more memory, because that sometimes we don't want to decompress all data. We might need to cache. It might be effective to adjust the cache compressed data. So that. If we use the block aligned approach, that it can be more so that we don't have some meaningless data to cache. So in place decompression is to avoid extra copy. So due to in place I/O, so you can see that some percent of a sequential read improvement. And additionally, we also introduce a rolling hash global compressed data decompression, which is used this way. Also, we also support block-based, FS-based, and file-based backend. So we have in kernel because we have some use cases. We indeed have some use cases with block based is not quite efficient. Maybe ComposeFS is one use case as well. So we found that based on the previous incremental FS discussion, that we found that there exists another in kernel caching management framework which is called FS cache. So we would like to reuse it to cache our image and do some lazy loading also called on-demand download, and maybe more use cases such as to just fetch some data from the FS cache caching management. So that is ongoing stuff. So the compression side, maybe the story maybe might some different, because that for the uncompressed stuff, maybe each extent is quite huge, and the information is quite sparse, because that we need to record rare thing. But the compressed extent is quite dense, because that we need to do record many informations in principle, because that I observed I previously maybe observed ButterFS, it record many stuff in its index. So if such index is too huge, the read performance might be in impact. So that such read-only FS recorded rare stuff. So that have some two ways, such as fixed size input compression, such as a squash FS, which just store a start physical offset per inode, and then it record a block list one by one. So that there are decompressed size is fixed, such as 4K or more. So in this way, that we have to sum it up to get each one physical offset. If we want to read a very large file, you need to sum it up to. So they introduce some cache to resolve the problem. So on the other side, but its index is quite small. So that I think the main purpose is to decrease their image size. On the other side that we have a fixed size up to the compression. So in this way, that because we are a block aligned file system, so that our compressed data is just fitting blocks. So that we just store is a physical block and block count and start a logical offset. So but in this way we designed a very efficient index. So in that way is that we have a more higher read performance. You can use FIO or something to benchmark it. So our recent use case is basically three forms. The first form is the EROFS 4 image, such as to use uncompressed image and FS desk for guest sharing, or some compressed image to do space saving, as well as to boost to save its performance. Another use case is just to use EROFS metal only image plus external data such as table or another binary image. That is possible. The rest use case is use EROFS plus overlay FS extended attributes such as compose FS model use cases to refer to external files. So that is a recently use case about our global compressed data deduplication. I think because we record a byte granularity deduplication with a minimized extended length of 4 kilobytes. So we can use a compressed data can be referenced for multiple times in the prefix form. So in that way, I observe that is much friendly, at least to test files. with a small compressed P clusters. But I want to extend it to a shared library, but the outcome is not quite good. Maybe it's modified a lot, not just as a simple patch. So I need to investigate more to get more ideas. You can see that this is a Wikipedia, but this is a two days different, has 2 days difference. So we can just use 4K compression. We can see 5%, about 5% to use such a deduplication. If it's just a 1 day difference, that's maybe more.
I can suggest why this is. It's basically because most images built on shared libraries, the shared library itself represents effectively all of the stuff that you can share between the binaries. Once you've done that, there's not much left in binary data that's fully compressible. You can compress it slightly, but it probably isn't worth the overhead. You know, as long as the image is built correctly with all the shared library systems.
You mean the overhead, just the index overhead or something?
Well, no, I mean that once you've taken out all the shareable bits in binaries using shared libraries, there's not much left in all of the binaries that will compress easily to give you a great data saving. You know, they're already effectively
decompressing themselves.
They can compress, but you're showing they're not compressing very well.
No. That is not a shared library. That is just a test file.
So
I mean, the left side is just a test file. We use the 4 kilobytes compressed. Sorry. I didn't mention the originally size. The original size is almost 2 gigabytes. Almost 2 gigabytes. It's already save something.
Okay, forget I said it.
Sorry, I didn't mention these lines. Sorry about this. So another thing that we compared with fixed size.
Just to clarify, this step is deduplication on the compressed blocks, right?
Yeah.
Right. So. Basically, there's an initial deduplication, there's compression attempt, which may be successful or not, depending on the data, and then you do another deduplication to see if any of the compressed blocks have the same hash.
No,
is that right?
we just rolling leftward.
Yeah.
We do some, but actually I observed the difference. That is too small splice. That is not huge as 4 kilobytes. So that we could not use this way to do deduplication for shared library.
Okay.
Maybe.
And another question I have is, so you are compressing fixed size chunks?
No. We compressed into a fixed chunk.
Okay. So you basically say, how much data can I compress into a 4K chunk?
Yeah.
Right. And then you move on to the next set of data and go, okay, I'm compressing and kind of compressing. Okay, 4K.
No, not in a tri-way because that's this is depends on the compression algorithm because I invest for many years. Many algorithm can adapt in this way.
Yep.
Yeah,
and you quote LZ4 and LZMA, right?
Yeah,
yep.
The next, will show that I'm working on deflate. The next step is deflate. I'm working on this, but I'm just to say that it will fix into a fix. But you can leave some space with a large unit such as 8K or more. You can left some space, so you can just use a traditional way as well.
And it wasn't quite clear to me what happens when you hit a block of uncompressible data. I assume you have a metadata bit that says this region is just not compressed, because I couldn't compress it.
Sorry?
Let's say you try to compress a encrypted file. Right?
No, it's not going to get any smaller, right? Shared library can compress.
Yeah, shared libraries can compress, but you might have an encrypted file on your file system, right?
I just the compare to shared library.
Okay.
Yeah, so so that no other
off.
File.
We can talk about it later.
Yeah, I will research it more. So sorry, I will go through. Another use case is called AR data set. That recently we have some AI data set have too many files, maybe four million files in one directory. So that that is with a compact with compact inodes, we can have some benefits compared with EIT4. So that is quite a use case and quite a benchmark for ComposeFS as well. So that is benchmarked with AI dataset. So that might have some benefits to use EROFS. So you can see the time is time can be saved. If you use EIT4, you have double time. So that's the difference. I have some ongoing development such as deflate decompression because that I have to I'd like to use Intel the resident hardware accelerator. So that is called IAA. So we use this. Compared with this standard, I will first adapt deflate. So that is my first step. The next step is I want to enhance the ComposeFS case. So I want to do a bloom filter for extended attributes. So that negative attributes can be speed up. So the finally is FS variety stuff. I've already talked with Eric. So I will email with is offline. Sorry about my English. I don't have enough time to do some discussion, but that is what I want to discuss. If we want to do some image based stuff to shape our distribution, some garden image, we want to modify it. We want to do some end-to-end, so we might need some such stuff, but I'm not sure that how to accomplish it. The last one is that we have some, I've seen some overlay FS partial copy up by using the clone file range. But if we mount a EROFS or whatever, look back or something, on XFS, so we can directly use it. So that I need to find a way if we could just use with loopback. So we could use copy file range as well, because that is on XFS. Because the image is on XFS. The EROFS image is on XFS, and we have overlay FS. But overlay FS cannot directly use clone file range to do partial copy up because the low layer is EROFS, not XFS. But in principle, we can do because that it is on XFS. So that we can just to do some copy up, partial.
Yeah, there's been work for copy file range across different super blocks of the same file system type. So you need copy file range across different file system types.
So you have a loopback mounted EROFS thing, and you want to copy part of it. If you look through the loopback mount, it's actually on a file on an XFS directory or an XFS. FS file system, so you can.
Yeah,
so you could punch through it and find the original location on the XFS, then you could do copy up.
Right, that's the problem, is like you don't know what you're on top of, and I don't know how we would expose that to upper layers in a safe way.
Yeah. Yeah, but that might be tricky. Anyway, that might be tricky. But we might finally want some way to do partial copy up. Anyway, the only way here is that the way is that. But we want to use partial copy up for image based.
Maybe I'm missing something obvious, but. Can't you just return an error on clone file range or copy file range?
But it will copy the whole file. It will copy the whole file and waste the space and time.
It copies okay, anyway, I was thinking the range, clone file range doesn't copy whole file. I may be missing something.
You can use reflink. Because clone copy range, you can just the reflink data and do partial copy up.
Yeah, and both of them accept error. I mean, they return errors if it doesn't support it. It seems safe. I don't know.
Yeah, that is safe. Anyway, that is safe, but you can do up for.
Yes, so it sounds like what you want to do is, kind of what he's saying, is have OverlayFS try and do a clone range between the two layers, just pass down what it to clone file range the inodes for both things.
Yeah.
And if they're not on the same file system, you get EX link or whatever it is that link.
Yeah.
It.
Yeah.
And then if it's on EROFS, EROFS just passes it down again and says, actually use this inode.
Yeah.
So the use case for copy file range across super blocks was the NFS. And SIFS can do it as well. Sometimes you have storage that knows blocks by context, so you can tell one server, copy from one server to the other without transferring any data. So basically, there is no support currently for copy file range between different file types, file system types. But if we would allow it, then the kernel gets a request to copy from EROFS to another file system. It's not trivial to see the semantics, but then suppose that EROFS deals with this. Mm-hmm. And EROFS knows what to do. So it gets a request to copy from EROFS to something else, and it knows what to do. So it can be done, but it's not trivial to define the semantics of how for the API, for the VFS API. No. When we allowed copy between different super blocks, it was like directed to same faces and time.
Anyway, that is tricky.
It's actually not the same file system type because I think SIFS and NFS have different sort of file system types. I think it's actually the same copy file range method pointer.
Right.
That's the trick. That's the trick part. But we need OverlayFS partial copy up. But by other way, that might be okay. But the currently,
but you just need partial copy up, or you need to be a reflink. I mean, partial copy up is useful. It can be done between any two file systems. Just copy part of the file. If there's a feature you're talking about that you need from OverlayFS, then it's a generally useful feature. It just needs to be done. There is no like format for defining a partial copied up file, but you don't need any support from file system or reflink for that.
I know that it doesn't support non-reflink file system.
Okay,
so
it's doable. Need to do the
but
work.
But we have some workload. But we have some workload. That such file is quite huge, such a gigabyte file. so
I
we
mean,
we
think
we
it's do quite a common workload, and OverlayFS has a problem in this workload, but it can be solved. I mean, it doesn't need reflink to solve that. I don't know. Maybe I don't understand the use case exactly. But
thanks for coming. Anyway.
Yeah.
Sorry about that.